Who's Jax?
He's my fiance. Oh yeah, she fucking bum rushes you.
I can't sleep on her.
And then she collapses on the floor.
Finding your fiance for you, and he's gonna bring him back here post haste.
Do you know where his shop is located?
So I'm gonna break inside his place.
So like 2 hours go by and Cliff doesn't show back up. So you knock on the door, and a human woman in her early to mid 40s opens the door. Like,
I'm looking for a man named Jax.
That's my husband. Well, I will be sure to pass him a message and he can see in the morning. You hear the door slam as you start walking away.
They're probably asleep. I'm going to break into their house.
I look like creep up to his side of the bed and I'm going to slowly and quietly nudge him.
He kind of stretches and he opens an eye and looks. He goes, "Holy shit!" And he like jumps in and pulls her out of bed and she wakes up and freaks out. Opens the door and pushes her out and he pulls out a short sword by the nightstand.
Yeah, I'm just going to come up and just hit him in the freaking face.
Great, I'm going to pull him to the window and throw him out.
You toss him out the roof and he kind of hits the ground and you hear like a crunch. You hear like a sharp whistle and a hey!
I'm literally just walking in, a little bit bleeding. I just pulled out some arrows out of me.
What happened to you?
Damn it. Fucking Jax is a dick.
Two men walk in that appear to have the same garb as the city watch and they'll both turn and they'll say, "There he is!" And they'll draw their weapons.
Alright, so what a very, very interesting session we had last week. So we managed to take care of some things with our blacksmith friend on getting some stuff taken care of. A lot of this stuff I know wasn't part of the stream, so it's just kind of like on last week's stream, so it's kind of like we're just trying to go with it, right? So what basically happened was we took care of all of our shit. We went to the blacksmith, got that all done. And after we went to the blacksmith and got that all done, we went over to the next day, went to the magician house. And oh, that's right. So with the blacksmith, we ran into a young looking small child. And Cliff, decided to go up to this child and show a bit of an interest because he was writing some notes down. It was kind of suspicious. So as the curious cat rogue, I decided to come up to him and ask what he was doing. I took a knee down. I tried to shake his hand, just try to introduce myself and be friendly. He totally ignored shaking my hand and just kind of like walked away, which was awfully rude. But hey, I just won't have to talk to him anymore. So we went back to we decided to go back to the Silver Unicorn to rest up for the day, have a few drinks. And then the child comes back again. It was like, what the hell? Is he even allowed in this bar? What is going on? Apparently he was a gnome or a halfling. They're all short to me and I don't care about either one of them. So it got weird, you know. Cashin tried to, you know, befriend him and everything like that. It wasn't very effective. And so we just kind of decided, you know what, we'll call it a night. And as the gnome went up to his room and rested for the day, I kind of snuck into his place that night to see about trying to find those notes that he was writing down. Because we're on a very important quest when it comes to preventing things that involves time travel. We don't want any kind of like timeline issues happening. So we decided to like try to take the notes. Maybe he was writing notes on that. But he disappeared. I broke into the room, looked around, nothing seemed disturbed. I mean, I didn't notice a bag underneath his bed that apparently he slept in. Like, that's kind of creepy, but whatever. So I left the room, left it the way it was, went back to mine, called it a day. Then the next morning, the group decides to meet up with Ulfgar Longwood to go to the Wizard. Go to the little wizard. The, what was it called? The Red Wizard Hasselrubble. I'm butchering that name, but whatever. We go to him. We just say, hey, we got this girl in a bottle. Can you do something about it? Yeah. He opens it up, lays it down, lays it out. Next thing you know, oh, thank you. We open the bottle and see what's going to happen. The girl just pops out and it's like, oh, Amelia Greyheart. She's okay. She's freaking the fuck out though. Wondering, oh my God, where am I? What's going on? What happened to the others? Yeah. She was a bit of a shock and she was like, rambling on about wanting to leave and see her fiance Jex, which by the way is a fucking asshole. He is a jerk. So we try to calm her down by the freaking halfling gnome child decides to come in. Apparently he had this meeting with the same wizard that we were with. And sees a commotion when he comes in, sees this commotion and puts her to sleep. We didn't know how long she was going to sleep for. So as she was asleep, we saw we had some time and Cashin just asked me, go find Jex and go see what's up with him. So I just say, okay, I'm on it. I was on a mission. So as I left, apparently the spell only worked for about a minute. So she woke up and talks about it. Apparently she was a lot more calmer. They managed to calm her down. But you know what? I was still on a mission. Cliff was out there. He's hunting. He's on the hunt. So he goes to a bar, says, hey, do you know this guy named Jex? Bartender says, yeah, he owns this clock shop. So it's like, all right, thank you. Gives him a copper, says, keep up the good work. Goes over to the clock shop. Apparently it was closed. Ask a merchant on the side, say, hey, do you know where he is? He's all like, nope, I don't know where he is. It's like, all right, then. Breaks it. So sneaks over to the back, breaks open to the clock shop, looks around, try to find another address or something like that to see if he finds the information where he could find a living residence for Jex. He managed to find the address and also pocket himself a nice looking watch or a clock. And so it's like, all right, leave it the way it was, lock everything back up, sneak the fuck out. So, all right, time to go to this address. Goes to the address. His wife answers the door. Freaking bitch. As I say, oh, that's very important. There's a friend of his that needs to, that he needs to see that's in dire need. Says, oh, it could wait till the next morning. What kind of person says that? They're in dire need. I know it was late in the night, but if someone's in dire need, come on. That's a friend of his? Come on. That's kind of messed up. Either way, so I say, okay, sorry. She says she'll have him sent over the next morning after work. And it's like, okay. Walks away. Wait for a good hour. Sneaks into the house. Breaks in. And tries to find Jex. Of course, I find him in bed with his wife as they're asleep. Comes up to the bed. Tries to calmly wake him. He freaks out, flips over his wife, falls onto the floor. She's screaming, runs out the door, tries to wake everybody up. He's going up to the door, grabbing a sword to kind of like keep me out from getting to the other side of the door. He's just freaking out. I say, hey, Amelia's alive. He's like, you got to come with me. I know where Amelia is. It's like, she's all right. He's like, no, she's dead. You're a liar. You broke into my house. I can't trust you. It's like, hey, I'm just telling you, she's alive. Come on, just come to the Silver Unicorn. Next thing you know, he cuts my face. Yeah. I wasn't planning to do anything, but since he wants to take it that way, things got real. So I managed to disarm him, and then he's on the floor crying on his knees. So I grab him by the hair, smack him around a little bit because he's not being compliant. Trying to make him more, you know, as I said, compliant. He's not having that. And then apparently I have to slip him out, not going through the front door. I can't go through the door. So because, I mean, his family's out there. So what I do, I crawl him up to the window. And mind you, it's a two-story window. Who would get her in a two-story window, like getting thrown out a two-story window as I throw him out. Thinking, you should be fine. It should be fine. So he falls down. He kind of like slumps there. I crawl down. I check him, make sure his pulse is fine. He's awake. He's alive still. He's alive. So, but then the guards start coming. So I pick him up. I like by the collar and stuff like that. Smack around a little bit and say, hey, you better go to the goddamn silver unicorn or you're dead. You and your family are dead. I'm on a mission. This is what a hunter does. When they're on the hunt, they get their prey. But unfortunately, not this night. Because the guards were coming. I had to get out of there. So I ran away. Got hit twice, though, with some bows. Like, god dang it. So I managed to outrun them. I didn't realize, though, as soon as I got through, everyone's all like, hey, what happened? Jax is a dick. He's a freaking asshole. And his wife is a jerk. And so they got the idea. He's married. This could be going bad. And as I sit down and tell them, boom, some guards show up. Get interesting. Scene.
Oh, alrighty then.
Dean, indeed.
So.
Is there anything else that I missed, though? I mean. I mean, you guys got some gold, too. You got, like, a sack of gold that you decided to split with yourselves. I didn't get any of that. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you missed, in theory, the stuff that the rest of the group did when they left. The wizards. But, yeah, who cares about those guys?
Yeah, who cares about that? It's all about the shenanigans of the rogue.
It's fine. It's not like we didn't complete, like... It's not like we didn't complete the actual objective of why we were there or anything.
Okay, what did you complete?
We woke What's-Her-Face up from the... Well, we released her from the bottle.
I did say that. Opened up the bottle, and she was fine.
You did. She wasn't fine, but okay.
She freaked out, and I said that.
Anywho's and what's it?
I can't remember.
So when you guys are sitting there eating, Black comes busting into the bar. He pulls some arrows out of his back, and he sits down, and he says something to the effect of, Jax is a fucking dick. He is such an asshole. Oh. They're like, well, where is he? And he's like, duh, he's still back there. He has a wife. Can you fucking believe that? Jesus.
He's a jerk.
And then the door kind of busts open, and you see two of the Night Watch step in and kind of scan the bar and then look over and notice Black there or notice Cliff. And they say, hey, there he is. And so they both have shields and they have weapons that are not yet drawn, but they are certainly prepared to. And they start sauntering up to the table.
Sauntering.
Sure, that's just the adjective that I chose.
I'm about to say, like, I'm about to like use a dictionary for that.
Okay, marching. They start marching up to the table.
Oh, I like there sauntering. I just wouldn't. I couldn't see a guard saunter anywhere if he was on duty. But skip they maybe. Start marching they up to just the skipped table. Up to the table.
Oh, maybe.
Says Neverwinter.
So, Shiro's just gonna kind of sit there and look to Cliff and look back to the guards and look to Cliff, look back to the guards. Cash and our resident gnome friend, what are your reactions to the guards entering?
I'm gonna hide under the table.
Okay, so the guards come in and hey, and then you guys notice the gnome just kind of his eyes get real wide for a second, and then all of a sudden, boom, he's not there, and you just hear him like almost shivering under the table.
I want a stealth check for that.
I mean, he can roll one if he wants, but they kind of know where he is. That's a real good roll, but they do know where you are.
But do they? Do they really? I'm going to look to the guards and be like, here I am. What can I do for you?
Yeah, they know where you are.
That
they'll be like, exactly. My first roll of the night, crit. It's only going to get down from there, gentlemen. So one of the men will again point at Cliff, and he'll say, "This one is under arrest for breaking and entering, among other charges. You are to be brought to the jail immediately. Come with us."
What are the other things? Because I completely understand breaking and entering. But what are these other things?
That doesn't warrant a jail sentence in and of itself?
No, because I broke in to bang your wife last night.
Do you actually tell him that?
Oh, hell yeah.
So they'll look at each other, and then they'll start to totally ignore you, and they'll turn to Cliff. And be like, sir, come with us.
You know what? I'm going to straight up say, what was my charge? I've been here the entire night.
Are you going to roll deception on that?
Hell yeah. Oh, wow. 18.
So what's insight? Insight's intelligence, right?
Wisdom.
It's whatever.
Insight's intelligence.
It's whatever. Insight? It is wisdom. Because it's insight.
How about that? So they'll both say, well, I don't see any. Where's your. What the fuck did I call it? Alibi. It's like, that's your alibi? Just saying that you've been here? We followed you here, sir.
My friends here can vouch for me.
Oh, damn.
Which one? The foreigner, the gnome hiding under the table, or the wise ass that we no longer trust the words that come out of his mouth?
Whoa, that's not what your wife said. Come on now. Be nice.
The gnome would vouch for me.
Clearly, I guess I'm
not saying that. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. Oh, my God. I'm gonna look to the monk and I'll be like, my friend here, the foreigner, will be more than happy. We're both foreigners and we've been traveling together for quite some time.
Is one guard speaking up more than the other?
One guard has been speaking, yeah. The other one is standing there also looking menacing, but
I'm gonna cast Charm Person on the guy talking.
Alright, how does Charm Person work?
Since they decide they want to ignore me.
Verbal and somatic. Wisdom saving throw, and does it with advantage if you or your companions are fighting it. Technically, you're not fighting it.
So there's no advantage, yeah, but...
The DC 17.
Jesus.
Roll well.
He probably will. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, my God. Yes.
Okay, so it's verbal and somatic, so cast your spell.
So as they pay attention to Cliff and he makes his last remark towards me, I'm just gonna kind of Jedi him and I'm gonna be like, I'm gonna say in Draconic, these are not the droids you were looking for.
So he's what? So he is charmed. It's actually a status effect, yes. It's been a while since I've had to look up any status effects here, other than poisoned.
Yeah, I noticed that.
I don't understand why you'd have to look up poison. Psh.
Hang on. I have a different thing. I don't have to flip through the book.
Poison.
I have my nifty DM screen here. I can just flip open.
How dare you be nifty?
Charmed creature cannot attack the charmer or target the charmer with harmful abilities or magical effects. Charmer has advantage on ability checks to interact socially with the creature.
So he had advantage basically with like deception and persuasion and all that stuff with him.
Yeah. And as soon as I do that, I'm going to get his attention. I'm going to be like, hey, he already told you that he's not your guy. I think you're on the wrong track.
All right, make your deception roll at a
22.
And so he kind of, like, his eyes are kind of, like, you know, glazed over a little bit, and he turns to a companion and says, maybe this isn't the right guy. They gave us a description. They didn't tell us, you know, anything else. And he was like, we did kind of follow him in here, though. Like, we watched him walk in. He fits the description. Be like, Karen will have our ass if we don't get this guy tonight. And then they start talking, and then it's like a little bit lower than you guys can hear now. They look like they're kind of discussing it now.
I'll speak up, and I'll be like, do you guys want us to help you find this guy?
Use persuasion.
Oh my god.
I mean, if you know where he is.
Well, what description did you guys get? Because we've been here all night. We'll be able to tell you if he came in here.
So, Cliff, I need a description of your disguise then. I need you to describe what your character looks like. Other than generic human.
Okay, so let's go with...
I need, like, at least a height, weight, eye color, that generic, some sort of description like that.
I'm going to say 5'7". He is roughly around 125 pounds. He has brown eyes, blonde hair. No, brown and brown. We'll go with that. And he has he's like not pale, but he has some skin color to him. He's not like bronze or anything like that, you know? He's literally like the average of everything that you can imagine of a normal human being. Those are like the best like five qualities I could say about him. He has no distinct marks or anything like that. So yeah.
And what was he dressed as?
Let me check out what his armor is, because he literally was just in his armor.
Your hat him look like whatever. That's how your disguise kit works. You can make it look like whatever it functions as it is. So your cat person is wearing leather armor, but your human disguise does not have to be wearing leather armor.
Okay, so I'm just going to say that he has a... I think he just looks like normal person with a normal, like, wool, like a linen shirt, some normal pants, like just ordinary clothes, like peasant clothes, you can even say, you know? Nothing like of upper class, but middle class. I'm gonna say brown. I'll just say, white shirt, brown pants. That's pretty much, and like some shoes, like not fancy shoes, just some regular shoes, which is also technically worth a lot these days. In that time, though, granted. But yeah, that's about it. Nothing, no jewelry, no nothing special. Just an ordinary guy. And I'm going to say technically he does have his hat showing, though, which is like... it's kind of like... not the Cat in a Hat. Like kind of like a top hat with a little bit of a red on it. Red and white.
Here.
Which is probably why they were like, oh my god, that's him! Look at that hat! That's totally what we were told.
What hat? Wait, what hat is he wearing? I missed the hat.
Like
I'm sorry.
It's like a top hat with like red and white, like a red and white stripe, kind of like what the Cat in the Hat wears.
Cat in the Hat. All right. I missed the hat part. I'm sorry.
It's fine.
I'm trying to find a generic human portrait that we we can use, but they're all terrible. They're all really bad.
It won't do them justice, I know.
Yeah. And they'll say, well, the report we got is that he was slightly below average height. He was a little bit skinnier fella, dark hair, and he was wearing a top hat. Not a dark man. He had a white shirt. He had some brown knickers on, and really, that hat looks awful familiar to what, or awful like what we were told to look after or to look for.
Well,
I mean, it's a very popular hat. I mean, there's a vendor like that was like in the south side of town that was wearing hats just like these. I'm pretty sure I just got them from the same vendor.
All right, you definitely need to roll deception there too.
Damn it, Black! You should have let me roll with that one.
Sorry.
I had a great story filled up. All right, it's all good.
Oh Jesus! They're like, well, it's. I mean, we do work. We work the night. And we're not. Out and about in the day very often. It must be a new vendor. Well, I mean, that's the description I have. We don't have any reward set or anything. We'll have to talk to the captain at the shift change.
Well, but, I will let you know there's only been one other person that has come through this inn. Real shady looking character. He darted in, ran upstairs real quick. And I haven't seen him since.
And they kind of look at each other and be like, what did he look like?
And I'll repeat, I mean, he's an average person. I mean, there was nothing very distinctive about him. I didn't see a hat, but I wasn't really looking that much either.
And they'll look at each other and then they'll look toward the bartender who's just been kind of like staring at this conversation mixed feelings, and they'll be like, all right, official duty, we're going to go and search the rooms. And he'll go, kind of reaches under and he pulls out a key ring and tosses it at the guard and he catches it, and they go busting upstairs.
And I'll look to the bartender and I'll be like, so sorry. And I'll flick him a gold for your trouble.
You're like, it's all right. This isn't the first time. I'm sure it won't be the last. Kind of get used to it when you run a tavern house and inn in the city.
Yeah, and I'll look to Black and I'll be like, so that disguise that you have, is that what it is, or can you like change the properties of it?
I'm going to go into the bathroom right now and change it right now. I'm going to go into an outhouse. Give me a moment. So I want to get up. I'm going to go into an outhouse.
They have a latrine inside.
Oh, okay. Then I'm going to go to the latrine, and I'm going to change look like. I'm going to be a little bit darker tone. I'm going to get brown hair, blue eyes. I will hide the hat, definitely, now. And I'm going to look a little bit more classy in my outfit. You know, like more... middle class, upper middle class, you know, like with a nice fancy vest and everything like that, with the black pants and the black vest and the white, like clear white, like nice and clean pressed looking white shirt with a nice looking fancy looking shoes. And then I'll just come right back out and I'll just sit right up with them. And oh, I will have a nice little ring too that looks like something fancy, like something of like a fam, like a known like a fam, noble ring. Family. Yeah, like a noble family would wear, you know?
So you're going to transfer, basically, the disguise of your cap to it being disguised as a ring, basically.
Pretty much, yeah.
Even though you still have a hat on your head.
But it just won't be seen.
Right.
Yep. So I'll just come right back, I just sit up, and I'll just say, hello, gentlemen. How's it going over here?
Oh,
you're
hi
the
there.
Strangest folks I ever seen.
Hey.
I'm saying something. I get some strange folks come into this bar.
Oh, trust me, you don't know the half of it.
Yeah, apparently not. That's all right. I'm not a fan of that particular knightsman, so I don't mind turning me head for a gold piece this time.
I got you. Promise it won't happen again, will it?
I look to the bartender to say, hey, if it happens again, I'll give you 2 gold pieces. Is that all right?
Yeah, I almost wish it'll happen then.
Hey, I'll pay you. Just keep quiet, okay?
Well, you guys hear footsteps coming down the stairs now.
Did you find him?
Didn't seem to be anyone of that description in any of the rooms. He must have either slipped out past us when we came up or hopped out a window. He's a window hopper, we found out. He likes to defenestrate people and throw himself out windows.
Oh, jeez. I hate those people.
Yeah, they're kind of the worst.
If we see him, if he comes back in here or we're on our travels, we are adventurers, we'll definitely get him for you and
if you decide
bring him to you.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, this will probably be the first place we post about when we make our new wanted sheets for the week. He'll be the first one. This will be the first establishment we pass by, so I'm sure you'll see it.
All right. I look forward to it, and good luck on your hunt.
Hey, thanks. And they'll kind of leave.
I like how they don't notice that the guy that was there earlier is no longer there, and that this new guy just like came up. So
they're not really paying attention at that point. They were just having conversation as they're trying to leave to go search for this guy.
All right.
They were kind of up at the bar, more directing their answers to the barman, even though they were answering your questions.
Well, that was
I really should hope this happens more often. Yeah, they slipped me some gold too.
Oh, there you go.
Hey, man, got some good business going on.
Absolutely. Sometimes crime can pay, that's for sure.
Trust me, I know this.
I think that counts for a round for us all. Yeah?
Maybe. I'm kind of more curious to know what exactly they are hunting you for, Sonny.
All I was trying to do is reunite two long lovers and the gentleman who resisted for me just trying to do what was right. He just was so rude. And I... Sir, you cannot understand about how like furious I am of how I was trying to do such a good deed and the gentleman was just so rude about it.
And so you threw him out a window.
He technically cut my face. You can't see it, of course, but he cut my face.
You threw him out the window?
I looked at you guys and I'm just like, hey, trust me, the guy's a dick. If you meet him, you'll know.
Remind me never to get alone with you in a window.
It was two stories. You guys act like you never, like, you would have died jumping out a two-story window.
And Shiro pops up and says, you have to remember, most people are not as quick and dexterous as you and I are, friend.
I mean, yeah, but still.
Remember, cats always land on their feet.
Enough with the cat puns. Jesus.
You started the cat puns.
Shh.
Anyways, it's, all this excitement is great and all, but I'm tired, and I gotta figure out what the hell I'm gonna tell Amelia in the morning. So I'm gonna go to bed.
Too. I'm tired too, but I think we need to hear the whole story, Cliff.
Okay. I go up to the bartender. I just simply sit there. I try to give him like these, like just sincere eyes, basically just like bluffing my way out of this, make it seem like I'm the victim here. And I tell him how I went to another bar. I try to get the information. I basically tell him all the steps I took, but of course I try to say it in a kinder way, like, I, like, checked the back door, you know, to see if it was still open, and I didn't say I picked the lock. I just say kind of like, I just tried to turn the handle. It was just open. I just walked in. That apparently he just forgot the lock up in the back, and that when I found out that I found his address, I went to the address, and that I make it seem like his wife was, like, evil, like the Wicked Witch of the West, kind of, like, fucked up evil, and that she was just being so rude and like threatened to call the guards, saying that I was harassing her. So I had to walk away. And then I slipped out into the house later in the night because I didn't want to get caught by that evil witch who was trying to get me caught. So then I go up to find him, that he was asleep, he was just there, like laying in bed, that I tried to like slowly come in, you know, and that he just jumped up with a sword and threatened to kill me and stuff like that, assuming that I was a burglar, which I told him I wasn't a burglar. And he just didn't believe me, and he said that he was gonna probably kill me anyway, so that way he'd tell his friends how he killed the evil burglar that broke into his house. And then next thing you know, I beat him up a little bit. We're fighting by the window and stuff like that. And that after I disarmed him and tried to calmly tell him the situation, he was about to shout for help out the window. So I kind of like tried to cover his mouth. And then next thing I know, I threw him out the window, like thinking that, you know, hopefully that he'll just not like get knocked out. I hope that he'll be fine. I didn't want to hurt him or anything like that, like lethally. I just want him to be okay. And I just want to like calm down so he doesn't like out me in front of the neighborhood. And as he fell out the window and he fell down, apparently these guardsmen were walking by. They saw this and just assumed that I was like trying to kill this gentleman. So I ran off. And then next thing you know, I mean, that they were shooting at me, and they, you know, and this is how I got here. This is how exactly went down.
You people really are some of the craziest crazies I've had in here in some time.
You know, do things a little differently. I will say that.
That's for sure.
Wow, so he's actually buying it? Okay, great.
You're telling him the truth for the most
part. Well, yeah.
The rest of your party may not believe that that is the whole thing of the truth, but this guy don't care. He don't really care enough, you know?
He got paid.
He got paid. He's got paid a pretty good night's worth just for your shenanigans.
I could bring him some more. That's what he likes. All right. So what do we want? So I think it's about time we just called a night. So it's like, all right, guys, well, I'm tired. I'm just going to go to my room. Okay, guys? Did everyone hear that?
I'd say halfway through your story, I called it a night. So I'm already up there.
I'm going to finish my food.
All right, well,
yeah, some way through your story, the gnome comes up from underneath his table to finish eating. The wizard walks away, and Shiro came up to the bar to sit with you and listen to your tale.
All right, and I tell Shiro, and the bartender's like, "Well, I'm going to call it a night. It was late. I'm hurt real bad. I'm just going to try and rest up and try to get myself feeling good again." So I go
all right,
up.
I'll add it to your tab for the week. So,
all right, thank you, sir. I just walk up and walk away.
Shira will follow. Well, on his way past, Shira will be to the gnome friend and be like, "Well, you meet us here in the morning to deal with Amelia, or do you have your own agenda?"
I'll be here.
I remember her saying to you that you heard of this this place. I can't remember the word you used.
Glitterheim.
I don't know where that came from. That sounded like Black, but he just went upstairs. Sounded like Cliff, but he just went upstairs. That was weird. So I remember her bringing up Glitterheim and seemed to know what it was. Maybe that'll lead to something. I'm not sure.
Well, hopefully that's the plan. I'll see you in the morning.
All right, will do. Sleep well.
Well, as long as no one breaks in.
Fair enough. And then Shira will go up, and Mike, you just finish your meal and head to bed, or are you doing anything
Pretty
else?
Pretty much. I'm going to do that, and I'm going to hide in the bag again.
All right, so everybody can have their full night's rest.
Yay.
Woot.
Fill up whatever was needed and whatnot. All right, so in Demernin, you come down for breakfast and... there's a little bit of commotion. You guys hear people kind of chatting about hearing the guards come in last night and there was an attack, and they're not really sure all that's all the information they know. They saw some of the guards out and about last night, and some of them are in here. And the barman, basically, any questions he concerned is be like, they told us there'll be more wanted poster the weekly update, so come back, you know, tomorrow they should have more information. That's all I know. And that's kind of the same answer he gives to any questions involving what happened. And in the morning, you assume everybody comes down and has something to eat. There's also you know, sausage and potatoes and bacon and all the fun stuff.
Ooh,
definitely coming down for breakfast.
Oh, absolutely. And then after, you know, after you guys get into your meal a little bit, Ulfgar and Amelia will go up and see you and come and slide a table over and some chairs and make kind of a big shindig, and Ulfgar will bring over some plates for them and they'll join you for breakfast, and you guys will have a nice quiet meal.
For once.
And after you guys are done eating, you know, Amelia kind of, or Ulfgar kind of says, well, it's nice to see everybody again. And he kind of looks over at you, Cliff, and he says, and you, sir, you're new.
Oh, yes. I decided to join on the adventures that my servant was taking part from me. I decided to see what it's like to be on the road. Don't mind me, my dear sir.
Okay. We'll kind of turn and look at Shiro and Cash and be like, we trust him?
Probably not.
Okay, then. In that case, I mean, we're here to talk about that that little problem that we had after this one.
Yeah, I wouldn't trust your pockets around him, but other than that, you can trust him with information. Just don't tell him to do anything.
Oh, understood. Okay.
Well, very rude, sir. I'm gonna drink my beverage, my water, or whatever they hand me, as with my little pinky sticking out too, as I hold the handle.
Your milk.
My milk, and like I lick it from the cup too.
I so want to press the digitation of a scorpion on your hand right now.
Anyway, and Amelia kind of pikes up as Ulfgar turns the conversation. He says, "Where's Jax?"
Oh boy.
Oh boy. Yeah, your fiance Jax. My servant told me about him, and so I paid him a visit. He was quite the rude of a person. Of course, my servant went to talk to him. And I was there, of course, in the distance. He said he was fetching them for me, and one thing led to another, and the gentleman was hurt. I'd be more than happy to go and accommodate and see how he's doing, of course.
So she definitely doesn't trust you, so you have to roll a deception for me.
Of course.
So, so be like, okay, I mean, he's always been so orderly. His whole life is, you know, he's got everything, you know, he makes outlines for what he's going to have for meals every week. He's kind of anal about everything. Ulfgar, I can't believe you didn't hear anything about him. It's like, I never knew him. Remember that. I mean, you left our group and met him after that. That's true, I forgot. It's been some time. I'm sorry, Ulfgar.
And I'll look over to Miliam, and I'll be like, there was one thing that we did learn, however. And
yes.
That is that Jex has moved on. He is married what? Now.
What?
I'm sorry, my dear, but it is so true that he is now married.
I can't take you seriously with that accent. This is gonna be...
When'd you become French?
When he became upper middle class all of a sudden.
I can't
believe that. I don't... Would you... What? Can you take me to him? And she'll look at you very desperately, Cliff.
I look to her and I say, well, I'm not sure where his exact position is. He's probably being tended to.
You said you just saw him.
He was probably being tended... Well, yes, but he got injured. And he's probably being tended right now.
How?
Hurt? My servant took it a little too extreme and threw him out a window.
Oh. I'm howling like a hyena now. And
she's trying to speak and she can't, and she's like starting to like hyperventilate a little bit, and she's looking freaked out, and Ulfgar's kind of like glaring at you like for freaking her out.
I reach up and I place my hand on her shoulder and I say, my dear, please, we'll go and check on him. I swear that he will be all right.
Like, no, I will check on him. And then she'll stand up and she'll leave the bar.
I'm gonna follow her.
As you stand up to go, Ulfgar will kind of like put his hand on your shoulder and be like, just let her go, lad. She's grieving. Let her go see for herself.
Yeah, but then what's she gonna do after that?
We don't know. She may cast a fireball on his wife. We don't know exactly what she would do.
Amelia wouldn't harm his family. She cares about him too much to harm what he cares for.
Many years have passed, my dear friend.
She hasn't changed.
We don't know that.
I do. Or I'm sorry. Did you spend the last 40 or 36 hours with her, or was it me?
Has it been 46 hours? Okay.
It's been over a day. So did you spend the last day with her, or was it me? No, I don't think so. She's still the same Amelia I knew from when I was adventuring with her.
But you don't know what the shock would may do to her, my dear sir. I'm not trying to be rude.
I understand that. Let me go and speak with her.
Then you go. That is fine. But somebody should tend to her to make sure that she will be all right.
She knows that's she can right. come to me, but I'll go and see her at the infirmary and yes. see what we can do.
Yes.
Until we get her back, I don't know what to have you do.
We'll maybe, be here.
Maybe you guys go see Hasdrubal and see if he dug anything up. I don't know.
That sounds like a splendid idea. You gentlemen?
I'm just going to sigh and look to Ulfgar. Yes, sounds like a great idea. Just send us a message whenever you guys are back safe.
Yeah, I'll meet you back here for lunch.
Okay.
And he'll kind of shake his head and give Cliff another, like evil eye, and then he'll leave.
I'm sorry, my dear sir. The truth could be so hurtful.
You're an idiot. Well, I'm gonna tail them regardless, because this has all the makings of a bad, bad story.
So, okay, so you're gonna tail them?
I'm gonna tail them stealthily and like at a distance.
Or you'll Ulfgar at least.
Yeah.
I'm going to join him as I go into the back into the bathroom, and I'm going to change my form to look like a maiden, and like a generic maiden as I'm going to walk out, and I'm also going to stealthily blend in with the crowd and tail them.
Okay, so you're both tailing them basically separately.
Pretty much.
Because I don't think the gnome's going to wait for you.
I won't even know it's you.
I'd just probably walk out with a girly voice and just be a little bothered.
I am God. Already out the door in a way.
Then I'm already going to be out. Well, if that being the case, I'm just going to walk out the door, of course, and just catch on to where they are. I'm going to run a little bit, of course, to try to like find them. I'm pretty sure I could be able to catch up to them real fast and find them.
All right, and Shiro, after they leave, will kind of look over at you, Cash, and be like, oh, you want to go see Hasdrubal or what? You've got something else you'd rather do.
We can go see Hasdrubal. That's fine. I want nothing to do with what those two are probably going to get themselves in trouble doing.
Yeah, I mean, we already went one night having to back them up. I don't know if I'm willing to do it, too.
No, not at all. Let's go see if Hasdrubal can give us some inclination on what to do next.
Absolutely. Okay, so I guess I will need stealth checks from both you guys. And then I will need perception checks from both you guys. As you follow... Okay, so you both are able to follow Ulfgar pretty easily. As he's going to, you presume, the infirmary. So you guys go, I don't know, maybe several blocks down, you make a left, you go another couple blocks down, you go to a big intersection with wagon traffic, and you make like a curvy left, and then you pass like a chapel, and then on the other side of the chapel, there's another longer road, and I'll need you guys to make more stealth and more perception.
Okay.
Okay.
So 15's good, 17's good, 13's probably good. Got a perception from Ganzap. All right, so Ganzap, you're having trouble keeping up. Well, not keeping up. You lose Ulfgar for a little bit. Roll me another perception. So you're heading down the street, you pass the chapel, and you kind of like lose him for a second. You think you see him, and you start turning, you go down a little ways, and then you think you totally lose him again. And it's just, there's a lot of foot traffic, and you're not sure that you're still following him. Mm-hmm. And you think you lost him.
Most likely. Mm-hmm. Dang it.
What do you choose to do?
Did Cliff say where the Jax was gonna be?
No, Ulfgar said that he was probably going to the infirmary though.
Do I know where the infirmary is at?
You do not, but you could find out.
I'm gonna go ask someone to ask where the infirmary is at.
Okay, make me... let's see, where's the skill list? Because they don't have... what you call it anymore.
Streetwise.
Gather information. Streetwise.
Or gather information. Or anything.
Investigation.
Investigation, that's a good one. Let's do investigation. 11's probably good enough. You'll come up to someone and ask them for the infirmary, and they'll give you the what's it to you.
So I'm gonna go visit a friend.
All right. What's it to you? Nothing's free in this part of the world, friend.
About 10 silver pieces.
Absolutely. Hand him over?
Yeah, I hand him over.
As you hand him over 10 silver, he looks, his eyes are shining in glee, and he says, oh, absolutely, you go, you're on this main road here, you go straight down the main road till you go to Bear Left, but instead of Bearing Left, cut right on the alley, and you'll come right to the back door. Thank you, kind sir, and he'll walk away.
Thank you. I'm going to try sleight of hand the silver pieces back.
Well, do you put them in his hand?
Well, I'm assuming he didn't put it in his pocket or pouch or whatever.
Well, yeah, if you put them in his hand, he immediately stuffs them in his pocket and gives you the directions.
Yeah. Yeah. So, then try and sleight of hand them.
Okay, go ahead. All right, roll me, you gave him 10, roll me a 10-sider. All right, and you're able to grab 4 back out of his pocket as he turns to go.
Okay.
All right, so Cliff, you weren't able to lose him. You saw Danzap kind of maybe lose him for a second and then turn and kind of go like the opposite direction. And then you keep following Ulfgar, I presume, or do you go after Danzap?
Okay. No, I'm going for Ulfgar.
Okay, so you keep following Ulfgar, and you get down to the end of the lane, and he makes like a right, and you follow him, and he goes up to this. It's like it kind of looks like it might have been like an old schoolhouse, maybe, and it's got like a big purple cross on the outside of it, just like a red cross sign, but it's purple on white. You see him like. His like little cape thing flap as the door closes behind him.
As the door is closing, I say, "My dear sir, please hold that door for me."
It's shut behind him. By the time you got up to the corner, it had already shut.
Oh, okay. Then I'm just gonna open the door as I come up.
Okay, so you open the door and it looks like this kind of like the reception area in like a Med Express. It's kind of like a little tiny seating area and like a lady sitting behind a desk. And he is, he's at the desk, talking with the woman. There's other people milling about.
Oh, okay. I'm just going to come up to the desk and I'm going to be like, "Hello, dear miss. Do you know where I could find a Sir Jex?"
"Excuse me. You have to wait in line, ma'am."
"Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Does Ulfgar not respond to me asking for the same person he's looking for?"
"I don't think he's paying it. He's not paying. Well, let's see if he hears you, because he's not paying attention, really." "Okay, yeah, he heard you." So he turns and says, "You're looking for Jex?"
"Yes, he's a good friend of mine that I heard that he got hurt, so we haven't seen each other for a while, but I just heard about him, so I wanted to check to see if he was okay."
Kind of looks back at the lady behind the desk and looks back at you and says, how do you know him?"
Well, it's kind of personal. We just were acquainted, if you understand."
"Uh-huh. Well, I'm with her." He turns and says to the lady, and she goes, "Fine. Let me go make sure it's okay with the on-hand doctor, and I will be back to call you in a moment."
"Thank you so much, miss."
"You're welcome." And then she kind of like leaves her little office area and heads into the back. And Ulfgar turned to you and be like, "Now, how do you really know Jex? And how did you find out he was hurt?"
Let's just say that Cashadin and them sent me.
He'll give you like the stink eye for a second, and at that point, Mike, is when your gnome finds the building.
Okay, so
enter said infirmary.
I'm gonna cast disguise self on me myself. Yeah. So I.
Did he cast disguise self?
am. There it is.
What are you looking like?
I'm gonna look like a dwarf with red hair and a really big mustache and beard, like down to my gut, and I'm looking super pudgy.
Okay.
And basic, and just basic clothes.
Okay. So you cast that on yourself, and then you walk into the door, and you see, as I described to them, and there's Ulfgar and this, I don't know, blonde, bimbo-y looking lady, dressed in like a maid outfit, or like a bar wench kind of uniform, like an apron and everything. And he's kind of looking at her with the stank eye.
I'm going to smirk. I'm going to smirk and I'm going to wait for the secretary person at the thing.
Okay, so you just kind of walk up to the counter and ignore them.
Yep.
All right, and she'll, and after a moment, you guys will hear some loud ruckus happening in the back of the place. And then you guys will hear the door kick open and a woman scream, "You let go of me!" And they had there's two like orderlies with an arm each on Amelia, and they're like dragging her out of the back. And they're like heading towards the entrance door.
I'm gonna lean over to Ulfgar and I'd say, "I believe that you were warned about something bad like this happening."
And he gives you another stank eye and kind of turns and starts to approach the orderlies. Mike?
I'm just sort of smirking. I'm just gonna be chilling, just waiting. Maybe get some popcorn. I don't know.
So Ulfgar kind of approach the orderlies and be like, "Hey, what's the meaning of this?" And they'll be like, "Stand aside, sir. This one is being disruptive. She has to be removed from the premises." And he'll be like, "Oh, I'll take her, and you know, you can leave her in my custody." And they'll kind of look at each other and look down at Amelia, and she's like lost her rage for a moment, and she'll be like, "It's fine. I know him." And they'll be like, "All right, she's your responsibility." And they kind of like toss her on the floor roughly, and then they go back inside. And Ulfgar like leans down and like touches her shoulder, and she kind of like smacks his hand away and stands up and like just and leaves the infirmary in a huff. And he kind of turns back and makes eye contact with you, Cliff, and just shakes his head and he follows her out.
"That's so rude." As I'm gonna wait, as does the nurse come out yet?
Yeah, after a moment or two, she'll come out and she'll be like, "Yeah, I'll take you in just a minute. Let me deal with this customer in here. Hi, Mr. Dwarf, sir. How can I help you?"
I don't know. I forgot it. That ruckus caused me to forget my question.
Okay. Do you?
I'm gonna leave.
Distance?
I have a headache. So I'm going to leave the building, rubbing my forehead.
"What a strange person. All right, do you still want to see Jax?"
I'm going to see Jax.
Okay.
I'm going to try and follow Wolf near and...
Black, there was a correct answer there, and that was not it.
Okay, and they'll and she'll lead you in the back, and then we will jump to Cash real quick.
Yo.
So do you guys go directly to Hasdrubal?
Yeah, no sense in dallying around.
Okay. So we'll since I actually have that. We'll have to clean the room up a little bit.
Oh, look, me and Shira are already there. Perfect.
Yeah, exactly.
Just...
So you guys come in, and he's just kind of at his desk, and the door opens, and you have permissions to enter since you're a member. And he'll kind of look up from his desk and be like, "Ah, gentlemen, welcome back. What can I do for you?"
I'll bow, and I'll be like, "Red Wizard, we're just here to follow up with yesterday's shenanigans."
Ah, yes, all the shenanigans. You know, interestingly enough, I got a message from the Night Watch last night.
Oh, yeah? What was that all about?
Yes, apparently a local wealthy merchant by the name of... what the hell is his last name? Did he have a last name?
I don't think he ever gave him a last name.
Dix Goldford.
There you go.
Apparently a wealthy merchant by the name of Jex Goldford was assaulted in his home last night.
Say it isn't so.
I do.
You can't trust anybody nowadays.
No, apparently not. You wouldn't happen to know anything about this, would you, Cassian?
Would you want to know even if I did?
Kind of looks up for a second and says, no, I suppose not. You here for anything?
Yeah,
a follow-up.
Yeah, the vial that we gave you, did you do any research on it? See what kind of magic was used to trap her or whatever?
Oh, the Gatorade-looking vial.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a pretty standard sorcerer trap of old. Yeah, it's been kind of phased out over the years, but some of the older arcane towers and some of the lone powers would pretty much keep several vials of that in their home so that if they were ever invaded when they weren't there, the thief could accidentally trap themselves, much like she did. Usually they don't leave them trapped for, you know, decades like that happened to her, so he must have either already trapped himself in his ghostly-looking lich form, or he didn't think to look when he came back for his experiments. I'm not sure which. But yeah, it's a pretty standard entrapment potion.
All right, well, that's good to hear. What about the angry bitch in the bottle?
Well, right now he's still under quarantine. I'm having one of my associates check when she gets back in town. She's more of a specialist on that type of magic, that the necromancy kind of deals. So she'll look at him when she gets back in town. I'm assuming sometime later this week. But he is under close guard and watch right now. I don't think he'll be too much trouble. It seems from my own little experiments, he has very, very limited power, some minor telekinesis abilities, and that's really about it.
Well, that's good, because I know all about his telekinetic powers. Little bottle-throwing bastard. Or bitch, I don't even know.
I think it's hard to tell. Most necromantic sorcerers tend to be male. That's just kind of how it is, so I would assume so.
Fair enough.
There's not many female lone powers. There never were.
Last thing I had for you, unless you've got anything for me, is we're looking into this place that you and the gnome were talking about yesterday.
Glitterheim.
Yeah. Did you have any more information on that?
A little bit. And he'll kind of stand up and go over to his wall of trinkets, and he'll pull a book off the shelf and bring it over and be like, it was familiar to me, but I wasn't entirely sure. I did some hunting in the library, and I came up with that it is an old dwarven fortress.
Oh.
Yes, apparently a few centuries ago, a dwarf by the name of Durgeddon the Black.
That sounds ominous.
I know, right? Very cool. Durgeddon the Black, I'll spell that for you. Durgeddon.
I just imagine him writing this in the air in, like, runes or something.
Yeah, he'll kind of. Well, he's just speaking it to you. I was typing it for your benefit. Excuse me. Might have to go get a drink here in a moment. So he says, okay, apparently, a few centuries ago, Drageddon the Black, his home, his clan was raided by a bunch of orcs and trolls. And so he was running and fleeing from his enemies, and his clan was searching for a new home. And after a while, they found a cavern system up in the mountains, underneath an old mountaintop they called the Stone Tooth.
Hmm.
And apparently they built their structure there for their new home, and they named it Glitterheim.
Stone Tooth. That sounds familiar.
It's in one of the mountain ranges to the east of here.
Okay. Yeah, our little friend decided that. Well, we decided we were going to help him, but he's got a bit of a revenge issue, and I hate to see somebody go off half cocked and get themselves killed.
I understand. Well, as far as I know, I'm not sure he'll find what he needs there. I know he's, some sort of tragedy befell his own family and his clan, and he's trying to find who did it.
Yeah.
That's really about as much as I'm willing to tell you without his permission. So that's really the only name he has. Apparently he followed some other leads of his and didn't really lead to much. Excuse the pun. And so this is a name that he came up with, and I'm not entirely sure why. I don't know if maybe one of the dwarven clan was one who attacked his family, or if the one who attacked was associated with the clan. I'm not entirely sure.
Yeah, I'm not either, but is there any like history past the point where they settled down in Glitterheim, or did...
Let me dig in here. Well, apparently those same orc tribe, or at least descendants of the same orc tribe, found them at Glitterheim and did attack them again. They sieged them for months, apparently. It looks like they were run over about 100 years ago.
Hmm.
Yeah, so, it looks like the same tribe took over.
So if we went there today, we wouldn't find dwarves, but we might find... Well, we'll probably find our orcs.
You may find a clan of orcs and trolls and goblins and that sort of thing.
Well, that makes us even better. Love killing me some orcs and trolls.
Yes, well, maybe there might be the history of what happened with your friend there, though. Even if that way you aren't disturbing a whole clan of dwarves, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that was the whole thing. I didn't want to go in there and just lay waste to a bunch of dwarves for no reason.
What's this here?
Yo.
Hey! Noel's here.
Hey. Sorry about that.
Hey, well, that's all good, buddy. We'll recap you here in a moment. We'll finish up what's going on. Basically, you and Cash are meeting with Hatsdrubal right now.
Yep.
So,
okay.
I was saying, now, what is this here? There's a mention of Durgadin's Vengeance? I don't know if that's... don't know if that's an item or just literally his vengeance.
Hmm.
Sure.
And it just name drops us? It doesn't have any connotation to it?
Yeah, I mean, this is in a very... it's a very old dwarven script. I'm not fluent in it, but I mean, I can read most of it, but that one, that kind of pops out.
Hmm.
Maybe it's an item of some sort. I don't know. Or if maybe it's literally... Durgan's Vengeance. I don't know.
I don't know.
And then he starts kind of like reading and like talking to himself. Like, here's another. And he almost like forgets that you're in the room for a moment.
I'll
kind of like see him like engrossed in the book.
I'll just speak up to him and I'll be like, we're supposed to meet our friends at lunchtime, so we're actually going to head out.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Listen, I will jot down all the information that I can that I think may be pertinent. I'll send it to your living quarters. I'll have a messenger bring it to you.
That's awesome. We're definitely going to be going out that way for one reason or the other. If there's anything I can do for the guild, pick up for the guild, you let me know.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Well, you're going after orcs, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we're never short of orc. Orc blood can be used in some pretty nifty potions. I mean, off the top of my head, if you bring back some orc blood, that might help some of the apothecary.
All right, I can do that for you.
All kinds of stuff. I mean, blood is always nice to use in experiments and potions, and we rather not use blood of those who matter, if you don't mind me saying.
I'd say I can get you some of that troll blood too.
Ooh, that would if you find a troll, any samples of the troll you can bring back would be perfect. We don't know enough about them.
Gotcha. I will get what you need and I'll figure it out.
Certainly. Yes, I will have this maybe not this whole book transpired, but I'll try to get a printout going, or not a printout, a handout written, and give you anything we need to know from the guild, and I'll have everything sent to you guys.
Sounds good.
Alrighty.
Enjoy your day.
Since I forgot to post it, how about for your completion of the quest at hand last week and stuff? Everybody get everybody take 500 experience points.
Yep.
Ooh.
Last week.
That wouldn't include me, would it?
I am going to include you, yeah, for your part in it. We don't want to handicap you too much, so.
You successfully put to sleep a wizard. That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, yeah. You kind of shut down a wizard. That's yeah. That's worth your experience points. And for successfully thwarting the guards, I am going to give Cliff and Cashadin both a die of inspiration.
Woo!
For your roles in keeping Cliff from going to prison and and Cliff Black having to have to talk and that outrageous accent for a little while there. I kind of hope he goes back to.
Oh, I plan to. Don't worry.
Not the French ass accent.
I mean, we are meeting up lunch with Wolfgar and What's-Her-Face, so, I mean...
That's true.
By the way, that's officially her new name is What's-Her-Face.
What's-Her-Face? Yes. Her name is no longer Amelia. It's
no.
What's-Her-Face. Yeah, because it does easier this way. What's-Her-Face. All right, so, where are we... We'll be doing at this point?
Well, I remember the dwarf saying he was going to follow Wolfgar and Amelia.
Yep.
Was he?
Okay. Yeah.
So he's going to do that, and I'll take some rolls from you for that. Stealth and perception. Maiden Cliff, what are you going to do?
I'm going to have a visit with Jax.
Oh, that's right. You're going to visit Jax. That's right. And then Cash and Shiro, where are you guys going? It's not quite lunchtime. You guys can probably do something else before you need to be back.
I don't think I have much of anything to do.
Yeah, I don't think I have any business.
Okay, well, I'm going to make my rules now.
All right, well, I'll find something to occupy your guys' time then. Okay, so that's good. And that's more than good. So you're able to follow them back towards the inn. So you'll get to another rather crowded intersection. So another perception stealth. Yeah, so as they get to one of the more crowded intersections, heading back towards the unicorn, you kind of lose them in the crowd again.
Well, at that point, I'm just going to go back to the unicorn, because...
Okay. Alright, yeah, you know where that is, so you're able to find your way back there with little strife. Alright, I guess Cliff... So you're led back to a room, and she says, they're in here, and it's kind of like a curtain over the door. It's not a real door, but it is a solo room, and you kind of, like, peek in the curtain real quick, and Jex is laying on the bed. He has both of his legs in the air in, like, rudimentary casts. His left arm is also casted. He's got a neck brace on. He's got, like, a... He's like shirtless, and there's like a like a large wrap around his chest, like his ribs area, and he's got like a black eye, and he's just kind of laying on this cot with his like upper body propped up, and there is his wife who is sitting beside him, and she's got a small child. He's not an infant. He's probably less than two. He's probably not quite two, but he's not really an infant anymore. She's kind of holding him. He's like asleep on her shoulder. And then there's another young boy sitting on the ground who is probably closer to four. And he's playing with like these little like wooden blocks. He's kind of just like stacking them up and knocking them down, that kind of thing.
Okay, so as I walk in, how does his mouth look like he's working? Like nothing's wrong with his mouth, right?
He's definitely asleep. He doesn't know. His mouth appears to be fine.
Is the wife awake?
Yes.
All right.
And she looks up and kind of looks confused at you.
I'm going to walk in. As I walk in, I want to look completely shocked and be like, oh my God, my dear Jux. I want to walk up and just like be on the other side, just like laying my head down on his chest, like, gently, in a very abrasive way, just be like, oh, what happened to you, my dear Jax? My dear lover.
All right. You feel like a hard tap on your head.
What is that?
Do you look up?
Yes, I look up.
As you look up, you get absolutely broad slapped right across the face. Oh. Bam, and it kind of knocks you back, and it stuns you for a second.
Can I, like, do a reflex real fast as she's about to, like lean back to, like, dodge it?
I mean, you can try to dodge it. I mean, she's gonna bitch slap you. She tapped your head so that you'd look up so she could just get her back and bitch slap you. She's ready for you.
All right.
Now she gets you. She gets you good.
What's that for, my dear lady?
3 points of non-lethal.
All right. What's that for, my dear lady?
And she says, I am his wife, and you will leave us in peace now.
Oh.
If not for him, then for the children, please leave. And she is very, very angry. I already had to throw one grieving bitch out today. I don't need to have a second person thrown out.
I'm not trying to start no problems. I just wanted to embrace my dear lover. I heard that he was hurt.
Yeah, he's fine. Now leave.
He's clearly not fine. Look at him. He's completely been
he could have died, but he didn't. He'll be fine. Now please leave.
Oh, I'm very thankful that he's still alive.
Yeah, hopefully no shit.
Hopefully that he'll feel way, way better when he's all healed.
I'm sure he will.
Oh, I will see him when he is better, I'm sure. You have a great day, madam. As I get up and I just walk away all snickering and stuff like that.
Can't say the same. You can hear her say that under her breath.
I just smirk as I walk out, thinking to myself, take that, bitch.
All right, so what's your next destination then?
Oh, I'm probably going to go into a bathroom or something like that. Change back to my like classier self. And then go to that bar I want to go to the bar with him to see if he's heard anything about those elves, those half elves.
Oh, back to your info bar.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So we'll head that way. Cliff. Cash and Shiro. On your trip back, a couple interesting things will happen to you. One is, do you remember when you first entered the city and those dogs went running past and the kids kind of ran into you?
Uh-huh.
That's going to happen again.
Jeez.
You see the dogs come out of an alley and just kind of run down the street and two little kids follow them and it'll be like, wait, Buster! And they'll kind of like brush into you as you go by, but you're ready this time.
I'd say, do I remember it?
But you guys remember this tactic, so you're ready this time. So you guys can both make, I guess, dexterity saves, we'll say.
Okay. Let's see.
All right, so when these kids run into you, you're kind of able to, like, adjust yourself and adjust your coin purses away from them as they scoot through and they run off down the alley, and you guys kind of look at each other and, yeah, we got them this time, jerks.
They still have your stuff, though.
You're not there.
Yeah, but when you get back to the bar, you find out that neither of you were wearing pants. You weren't prepared for that. No, I'm kidding. So you guys, make me perceptions as you get to one of the seedier parts on your way back, one of the less, what shall we call it, less traveled. Yeah, it's not as busy.
That's about what I expect with perception.
Oh, come on.
So neither of you notice this event that I was kind of hoping you would notice.
I mean, if you give us advantage.
I had like plus 7 than that.
You know what? What's your passive perceptions? Because that would make more sense anyway. I guess yours would be 17.
Mine's a 13.
It would be a 13. Okay. We'll use your passive perceptions and be nice. God damn it. Use your passive perceptions, and you guys will kind of walk by this alley, and you'll hear this, like, and then you'll kind of turn, and you'll see, like down this, like, garbage lane, it kind of looks like. There's, three, like, dudes, like, kind of more burly, thuggy-looking guys, and two of them are kicking at something on the ground. And there's the third one is, like, its back to you, kind of blocking whatever's on the ground. It's just kind of standing there with its, like, its arms crossed, and the other two are just kind of, like, kicking whatever, and you see, like a sword on its back, on his back.
Do we hear what's, or can we tell?
I mean, you can tell something's getting the shit kicked out of it, but you're not really sure what it is.
This is all on you, because my character would not give a shit.
Damn it. Yeah, I suppose it's... I'm like, hey, what's going on back there? Just call out to those guys.
Cash is like, the fuck you doing?
I'm just going to smack my forehead and be like, all right, fine.
So it appears that it didn't, whatever didn't hear you, whatever it is, didn't hear you.
Okay, I'm going to approach them and, hey, what you guys doing there?
And then we'll kind of turn, the other two will kind of stop what they're doing and turn, and the other one will kind of like half turn and see you guys and be like, this ain't none of your business.
All right, fine by me.
Can I now see like what they're who?
He's still kind of blocking. Make a perception for me. Don't roll a 1 this time.
Come on.
That was what you were not supposed to do.
Oh wow! I thought that was gonna happen too for some reason.
So it might be some sort of like large dog.
Might be.
Might be.
Could be a goat.
It's still kind of bungled and or bundled up and like maybe a fetal position, but
I can probably at least tell that it's human, right? Or is it
not
at
with
least
a
humanoid, not with a one?
So I'm gonna look to Shiro and I'm gonna be like,
that's fair. Right.
Is this bothering you?
Look, they're clearly beating someone up. I don't know who.
Step off.
So I'm just gonna look to the guy and I'm gonna be like, listen, you guys need to stop what you're doing or I'm going to rain all sorts of holy hell down upon you and your loved ones.
And who are you to tell me what I can and can't do?
I didn't even get to roll my intimidation, damn it.
Well, go ahead and roll.
Thank you. Yeah, I wanted to get that one out of the way.
And who are you to tell me what I can and can't do?
I went to London because I was like, what, like, are we in Britain or something like that with that voice?
Shut up.
All right, so I really hate it when people try and talk down upon me. So I'm literally just going to thunder wave these assholes out of the way and find out what they're kicking.
Jesus.
Yeah, way to take things too extreme.
Can you protect with thunder wave?
I can protect myself and any ally or person I can see.
I mean, if you're... How does ally work? Are you considering them an ally, or they're considering you an ally?
Let me specifically look at this.
I
would think it's whatever you classify as an ally, would be my guess.
Is it by ally, or just... like anybody that you just choose. Like, you could suddenly say an enemy that you want to hit everything but a certain enemy, I think.
If it literally says ally.
When you cast an evocation spell that affects other creatures you can see, you can choose a number of them equal to 1 plus the spell's level.
Okay, so it's not an ally. It's a creature.
Yeah. It's a creature.
You can choose the blob on the ground as something you...
If I can see it, then yes, I will choose to protect it.
Okay, so they're each going to get a roll here. What is it? Constitution?
Yes.
9, 5, 13. Okay, so they all go flying backwards.
Yes.
Oh! And you see on the ground, it is definitely... It's definitely humanoid now. It's in, like, all black... It's wearing all black. You can't tell if it's like cloth or just like dirty leather. And they're in like the fetal position, but they're like whatever it is facing away from you.
Okay.
It's small-ish. It's not like child size, so it's not like a halfling.
Okay. I want to approach that person.
And I will take a step forward towards the three guys and basically guard him as he's checking out whatever this is.
Okay, we're gonna have you guys roll for initiative, and I need to find a fucking alley.
We'll take a nice average initiative.
Alright, we'll say that's where you're at.
Okay. Oh, yeah, I can't select my token again.
God damn it.
Bye.
There you go. Got it now?
Yep.
So the guy downed has an initiative.
Ooh, shoot.
Oh, there's your third crit of the game.
Yeah, and they've all been goddamn useless.
The guy down goes first.
Yeah.
And then those other initiatives.
Oh, that's great.
I think this group's done before it even started.
And they'll kind of like stand up and be like, "Hey, you'll pay for that," and then initiate.
Okay. Is the guy in front of me conscious or?
No.
No. So now I can tell what kind of person is this.
Looking down at him, it is a elven blooded. You can't really tell if it's a full blooded elf or not because that's not you. It's not something you're super familiar with. Like, everyone in your village has mixed heritage, basically.
Yeah.
So he's some sort of mudded health or mudded blood elf. He's dressed in all black. He's got like a belt where there would be like maybe spots for weapons, but it doesn't appear that he has any sort of defense on him at all. And what he's wearing is some sort of super crude leather.
Okay. Is he conscious?
No.
No? Alright. And what can I... What are these three guys that are beating him up wearing? Or do they look like guards?
They're wearing leather, and they have like black like cloaks looking things on. And they are all wielding maces and crossbows.
Basically, like, look like average mercenaries. Something.
Yeah,
like
they look like thug mercenaries. Except this guy, he's got a two-handed sword, the guy up in front. They do not have... Well, yeah, this guy's got a two-handed sword and wearing leather. These guys all have maces and shields. These guys have maces and shields.
All right. Well, he's still breathing. He's still alive, right? This guy in front of me.
He's certainly breathing. Looks like he's not doing too well.
Not doing too well. Where's my alignment? I am going to
You're chaotic, not lawful. It's okay.
Well, he's still alive, so... You know what? I am going to dash up front. Jump over Cash.
I'm impressed already.
And...
I'm just going to look up to you jumping over me and be like, there is plenty of space around me.
Alright.
Let's make a point.
I'm not going to attack first, am I? Yeah, let's do that. Alright, I don't know what you guys... why you're beating up this poor elf? Half-elf? Is he? An elf, right? Is he?
Yeah, it's some sort of elf blood in him.
Elf, yep, elf blooded. Alright. But you guys need to back off. Okay? I'm just gonna use one of my key points to do patient defense. So whoever comes at me next will have disadvantage in their attacks.
Okay.
Oh. I just realized if Shiro went up to somebody and shoved them, it's actually a lethal attack.
If I want to.
Gosh.
Oh, the guy's not gonna squirm or anything?
He like coughs blood.
Ow. Oh, blood. Oh, okay. I am not...
I mean, you just hear him cough. If you're not paying attention to him.
I'm not learned in the ways of healing, so...
That would be me.
Let's see. Really don't want to initiate anything. I am going to take a step forward and place my hand on Shiro's shoulder, and I'm like, you should listen to my friend, and I am going to cast Mage Armor on him. So your AC is now 13 plus your Dexterity modifier. And then plus whatever other bonuses you have.
13 plus...
Who isn't wearing armor? Are you wearing armor?
No, I'm not. I'm a monk. So I'm wearing cloth. So I'm not wearing any kind of armor.
Isn't your AC already become higher than that?
Well, my AC is already 21 with an armored defense. If he's going to put mage armor on me...
plus dex plus wisdom. So your AC is a 24 now. Great.
Well, good luck
hitting guys, him. These guys now have to crit to hit you.
That's kind of the point.
Yeah.
So, meta-wise, you just made it so that they cannot hit on anything below a 20.
Hey, maybe they'll get intimidated from not being able to hit and getting their faces punched in. It's like, alright, this ain't worth it anymore. Let's get out of here.
Boom. This guy is,
Oh, and my mage armor appears as, like, a not like a deep red, but like a light red glowing all over his body.
But guy kind of scream, kind of looks at you and says, "Yeah, you'll pay for that, you mud-blooded tree hugger," and he'll swing his axe at you. Or his sword.
Wow, humans are really racist in this campaign. Jesus.
He gets disadvantage. BT dubs.
Today.
Not that you can roll much lower, but
not that it matters. He'll kind of swing sideways and you just kind of duck under the blow. And as he does that, these two guys will kind of bust forward and go on either side of him. And they'll swing their maces at you. And they'll say, "Yeah, you tree hugger. Looking twig." And then they'll swing at you. And these guys have pack tactics, so they'll just swing at normal. Jesus. And so the one on the right comes up and swings, and you kind of like bat like the hilt or the like the not the ball of the mace, but like the metal part. You kind of like bat that to the side, and then while you're in this like half like matrix stance, the other guy does like a clumsy swing at you, and it like hits off your arm, but the mage armor kind of helps, and it kind of pings off, and he's like, "Oh shit!" Like he knew he should have hit, and he looks confused now. Like he knew he should have hit you there. Now it's your turn as you kind of like readjust yourself.
Alright, well, I told you guys to back off. Looks like you have no. looks like you don't want to retreat. Fine then. So I am going to reach out to this guy in front of me and use my shocking grasp
on his testicles.
No, basically that, like I basically
was that
reach
your roll to hit the 24?
Yep.
Okay.
I basically reach out to this to his sword and like shock the sword and use that to to send a current to his body.
Great.
Yeah, so you kind of like jot your hand with electric and you like pat like palm the side of the blade and like goes into his hand and he goes and shocks him pretty good.
Alright, and I'll use another key point to do flurry of blows. So, going to punch the guy on the left, or I guess on my left. So this one. And another one for the guy on the right.
You get a punch, and you get a punch, and you get a punch.
I guess that one misses.
So the guy on the left, he's like kind of overextended himself when you ducked his mace, and you kind of like crack him like in the jaw in like the side of his head, and you hear like a little bit of as like part of his jaw kind of breaks a little bit. And then the other guy, even though he just glanced off of you, he didn't swing super hard, so he was able to just kind of put his shield up, and you kind of punched him right in the shield.
Alright.
Is that it, Monk?
Yep. Told you guys to back down, but here we are.
Oh, alright.
Oh, what?
That would be two death saving throw fails.
Go ahead, Cash. You hear another cough and spatter behind you.
Alright, so I'm gonna put my staff in front of me and I'm gonna be like, you weaklings will never learn. And the obsidian gem on my staff is gonna glow brightly and flames will pop up from my eyes and all of a sudden a fiery bolt will strike each one of them.
Scorching ray?
Yes. That's for the guy in the middle, this is the guy for the right, and the guy on the left. Oof. Poor guy on the left.
Well, that's the only one that hits. Oh no, I lied. The first one also hit. The 12 hits.
Okay, so...
And they have shields... Shields is a 2, right? Oh, they all hit then. I'm sorry. All 3 hit. They have
okay. So the 12 goes to the guy on the right. The 6 goes to the guy on the left. The 6 goes to the guy in the middle. The 3 goes to the guy on the left.
Right, now in the middle. Guy on the left just kind of gets clipped by it. The guy on the right, like, just as he peeks over his shield, like, takes it square in the face. He's screaming as his, like, the skin on his face starts to blister. So after he catches fire and they see you cast magic, he'll kind of, like, take his sword and he'll look around and look past you guys and be like, alright, deed's done, let's get the hell out of here. And he'll disengage and run. And the other two will follow, so they're all going to disengage and flee. Unless you guys are going to chase them, we can end combat.
Nope.
No?
No, I'm just gonna scream after them, and if I see you again, I won't be so kind.
And they will flee.
Wow, they're little scary little things, aren't they?
Okay, so...
Sonic the Hedgehog shows up, and he says, "All right, guys, good job! I love hot dogs!" And he runs away.
Alright.
Chili cheese dogs and runs away.
I'm going to take out one of my potions and give it to this guy.
Roll me perception or medicine or something to that effect.
Medicine, perception. I have a decent medicine score. 16.
Alright, he does not appear to be breathing.
What?
A lot of blood coking, like fresh blood on his mouth and chin and kind of on the ground where he like kind of coughed it up. He doesn't appear to be breathing.
He's completely dead, right?
He appears to be dead, yes.
Damn it. Just punch the ground. Fuck.
What happens when on his death saving throws he rolls a 6 and a critical fail?
Oh, wait, he made the first save?
It was a 6.
Oh, he didn't. Shit. Fuck.
I didn't even see the first one.
Yeah, I didn't see the first one. I thought that was the first death saving throw.
Oh, well.
No, the first one was right before Ganzap said they are not too amazing. Oh no, that was the plus four. Where the hell is a six at? I rolled it. I remember rolling a six.
There's a six up here, but that was for initiative.
Oh, it's right before your mage armor.
Yeah, that was for initiative.
Well, you cast your mage armor during your turn.
Oh, okay, I see it.
The nine was the main guy, and the other twos. The crit was for his.
Oh, I see it. I see it now.
Lots of success back there. Any.
I mean, the only thing we could do is take him to a shrine or cleric, and they can resurrect him. But I don't know if they're gonna. They're not gonna do it for free, and I don't want to spend coin on somebody I don't know.
And Cash, you also know that that is incredibly expensive.
Yeah. Hence why I'm not spending the coin.
Like 10,000 gold.
It's not that expensive.
It might be, actually.
Does he at least have anything on him, like on this person that identifies him or anything like that?
I mean, as you kind of pat him down, and not really. The more you look like him, the more you look at him, the more he looks like he was he's in all black leather, and has no weapons or pouches, but it looks like he had slots for them. So like maybe he was some sort of like rogue or minor thief or something that these guys beat the shit out of and looted him already or something to that effect. That would be your best guess. He looks like what he's wearing could hold coin pouches and weapons, and he has a slot for where would be a sheath would be, but he's not wearing any of that. He's literally just clothed.
So I know you said he wasn't elvish.
Yeah, to you, he doesn't look like he's a full-blooded elf.
But how closely does he resemble Black's first disguise?
Well, he's definitely not human.
Well, see, I never heard anybody say human. I just heard that he was a certain height, weight, and color, hair, and eyes. Nothing about what heritage he was.
We found the guy.
Following a human.
It is nighttime. I'm thinking they're getting a lot of details when they shouldn't be.
Black, was your guy a human?
Yeah, he was a human.
Thank you.
Yeah, everyone was human.
Even says on the wanted poster.
You had the perfect chance to lie to me there, and you didn't.
Fine.
All right.
Just being honest.
I mean, other than the fact he's not human, and his clothing are obviously not the same. I mean, he's close. He's probably 5'6". He's relatively average half elf. Well, I guess he'd be a little bit short for a half elf. He's got like light brown hair. Like his hair's like super super light brown, and he's thin.
So, I'm just gonna take a shot in the dark here. And I'm going to look to Shiro and be like, hey, I don't know how ethically you are about all this, but we could totally turn this guy in for the, I don't know if bounty is the right word, but for the contract they have out on our fellow party member and get him out of the clear.
You're saying we use this body?
Yeah, I mean, you're strong enough, you could hoist them up, and all we have to do is find a guard that's nearby and be like, hey, I think this might be the guy we saw last night.
And Shiro just thinks about this for a while.
Tainted.
Breathe out, and sure. Before that, before we take him, or take his body, I sit there for like 5 minutes and offer him a silent prayer. And then, all right.
I'm going to look to Shiro and I'm be like, but there's one thing we have to do that you're not going to like. I'm not even really going to like it too much.
What is it?
We kind of have to give him 2 arrow wounds. Or at least piercing wounds. I could probably do it with, like, a dagger or something.
You know what? You do it. I'm walking away a bit.
That's fine. So, I'll try to remember where Black was hit with the arrows, or Cliff, and I'll just do, like, two quick little one-inch stabs in those locations.
Roll me history, see how close you are.
Ooh, I'm trained in that. Yeah.
Yeah, you're not... I mean, it's a dagger as opposed to... Well, you rolled a 9 and a 19. It's a dagger, not an arrow. You're aware that it doesn't look exactly the same, but you're pretty sure you got the spots pretty dead on of where Cliff was shot.
Okay.
Where 13 was shot.
And then I'll yell over to Shiro. All right, it's done. Let's go find ourselves a guard.
All right, I carry his body up and find a guard, I guess. Z?
One moment, please.
Oh.
Sorry. Alright. So, yeah, you leave the alley and you'll get a bunch of looks, but you'll be able to find a guardsman pretty quickly. They're pretty much all over town, but they're not, like, in a vast number, but it's pretty easy to find one.
So I'll approach him and be like, "Ah, good day, sir. There's this guy that we ran into. We didn't kill him, but he..."
And he'll kind of, like, close his eyes at you and he, like, grabs hold of his sword.
But he matches a very close description to the guy that you guys were looking for. Jumped out a window or hit somebody or something last night.
Boy, you talking about the Goldford home invasion?
Sure,
know that's his last name.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah, that's it.
All right.
We're just trying to do our civic duty and bring him to you. do you want us to leave him here with you?
Well, we haven't been able to. Tomorrow morning is when we distribute the new wanted postings for the week. So it's not out yet. But we're supposed to bring the body to the captain, and then the body will be ID'd by the wife, by Mrs. Goldford. And if it's the same person, then you'll get your reward. So if you want to follow me to the guard station.
Actually, I'm not really in this for the reward. Like I said, I'm just doing my civic duty. I can leave him here with you. If you want to toss me a couple silver, a couple gold, that's fine. But I'm leaving this in your hands. You can be the big hero today.
Yeah, I'm not paying you nothing.
That's fine. Then just take the body.
And you? You want the reward?
No, I just approach. Are we in a guard station or is this, like, just...
You're on a not as well traveled road. It's not a main street, but it's a street. So you know what? It probably is a main street since it's a guard.
Alright, I'll like carry the body and just put it, like, leave it in front of the guard and say, "Here, take him. You can take the reward for yourself. I'm not interested in that."
All right, well, I guess thanks. And he'll kind of, like, look down and, like, check the body a little bit and be like, "You sure this is him?"
It's the description
he
looks
like I heard. He looks like he's wearing the armor of a guild member. I guess it wouldn't have been too much for him to dress up different.
Guild member?
Yeah, we got a couple different minor thieves guilds running around.
What is he wearing? Something from, like, a major faction, or is this just something common?
We just typically associate the black armor with a thieves guild.
Gotcha. I mean, that makes sense. Thieves guild breaking into a rich home.
It would. I mean, normally they'd wear their armor instead of, you know, I think, what, white and linen. that I remember the description being, but eh, what do I care? I'll take them back.
All right. Appreciate
it. Give me some gold.
Hey, there you go.
He's worth more alive, unfortunately, but I'll take it.
If I would have found him alive, I would have brought him to you alive.
The whole month's pay for me. All right, thank you.
All right.
All right.
Okay,
there's no way in hell I was going to try and do that.
I guess we'll all meet up at the inn then.
Yep.
You guys meet up for lunch. The gnome is there first. And then Jex, you, or not Jex, 13, you come in as your gentleman, your new gentleman with the signet ring.
He's going to be right back.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I missed that. Three comes in next and sits down next to you, gnome. Next to you, Jin Fizzle. Fuck's your name? Ganzap. It's going to be a while before I remember.
Okay.
Where the hell was Jin Fizzle from?
I don't know.
Oh, Critical Role. That's a great book series. Critical Role. It's a book series that's D&D related. I highly suggest it. One of the gnomes on there, his name was Jin Fizzle.
Jin Fizzle?
Mm-hmm. All right, so you guys will walk in, and Jin Fizzle and 13 will be having lunch. And after you finish, Amelia and Ulfgar have not showed up yet.
Well, that's not good.
I mean, you guys have been there for maybe like 25 minutes, a half hour.
Did anyone else show up yet?
I mean, all four of you are there now.
So where is Wolfgar and...
Amelia or what's her face?
Same person, according to the cash.
We're all there now together, right? Okay.
Yeah,
you're all together.
They're supposed to be following them, right?
They were supposed to meet you here.
Interesting. Maybe they got sidetracked or...
So, who saw them last?
Well, I saw him while I was out, and then I lost him because I'm so short.
Fair enough. I mean, it's hard to see
everybody. I have little legs. It's hard to keep up with everyone. They're taller.
All right. I mean, we could always go by his coffee shop, see if they're there.
Yeah, that might be the first place we should look.
Well, lead the way, because I have no idea where that's at.
All right. One of us should stay here in case they show up, though.
I'll stick around.
Don't get into trouble. Please.
What? I don't trust him unsupervised now.
What's the worst that could happen?
You dropping a person out of the second story building?
No.
Oh, I don't know. You implying that this guy that she's looking for has been sleeping with other women? I don't know. That's pretty terrible.
That was just a personal matter, okay, if you're cutting my face. It may have not been deep. It'll probably heal in like a week. It's like not even show anymore. But he still cut me, okay?
Well, I don't feel safe with you being here and meeting them. So I'll chip. Don't even ask that one. You've already done what's the worst that could happen. Why?
Is that the worst that could happen?
You know what? You stick with Cash. I'll keep an eye on 13 here.
All right. Okay. That sounds fair.
Come on. You got the good moral elf here to keep me in line. Well, come on. Things will be fine.
I don't trust that for a second.
I'm here and I don't even trust that for a second. I still don't trust them.
Okay, well,
I would like to say congratulations. You have officially, as the rogue, turned the party against you, and that is what every rogue strives to do.
We don't try to do that. We try to manipulate and use the group to our advantage. That should be the job of a rogue.
All right. So, me and Jen Dizzle or whatever are going to go to the coffee shop.
Probably nearby, right?
Every once in a while, I'm going to type that in just so that I don't forget it. All right, because you guys go over to the coffee shop, and you walk in, and it's afternoon, so it's not as busy as it would be in the morning, but there's a few patrons in here, and as you two walk in, you see the young girl at the counter, and she looks up and sees you guys, and her eyes get real wide, and she like goes in the back, like as soon as you guys walk in.
I'll go up to the counter and be like, "Hey, get a little service here, maybe."
And after a few moments, Ulfgar will come out from the back, and he looks very tired, kind of worn out. He'll be like, "I'm sorry we didn't meet you. Amelia's been pretty upset, as you could imagine."
Sure. Only issue is, we're kind of here on a temporary visa. However they say that back in the olden terms.
What's a visa?
let me rephrase that. I just looked at him. "Well, we're kind of not supposed to be here, but we are. So, and she's our ticket home."
I'm not entirely sure I understand.
"We were sent back for her. We have her. We don't know what we're supposed to do next, and I'm assuming that has everything to do with her."
"All right, well, yeah, come on back. We'll see if we can better a little bit." And he'll kind of let you in behind the bar and go back behind the serving area. And she's like, this almost looks like a live-in guest quarters kind of thing. It's got like a small coffee table and like a wheeled cot. Mm-hmm. Amelia's kind of crumpled up on the cot, just like shakily breathing, like she's just come down off of like crying really heavily, but she's not like tearing up anymore. You don't think she's facing away from you. She's just kind of like that kind of breathing. Ulfgar will be like, walk over and kind of like put her hand on her shoulder and be like, "Amelia, sweetheart, we got the friends here to, I think you need to chat with the ones who untrapped you from your bottle."
"Who rescued her? Just say we rescued her."
And he'll kind of look back and give you the eye, and he'll be like, "Just let me do a talk, please."
You know, he gives that eye a lot.
He turns back, and she's kind of rolled over and be like, "Okay." And her eyes are all red and puffy, and her, you know, there's like streaks down her face. She's obviously taking this incredibly difficult. She'll be like, I don't want to sound not grateful for saving me. I just, this has been a very trying couple days since I came back."
"Oh, I completely understand. You get trapped in a bottle for 20 years, you come back and realize that everything you knew is completely different and not yours anymore."
Yeah, that's the understatement of the century, I think.
However, the one thing that you don't know about me and my companions, and I'll look over to the gnome, and I'll stop mid-conversation, and I'll just be like, can I trust you?
Well, I figured already, so go on ahead.
Okay. So I'll look back over to Amelia, and I'll be like, we're actually from a different time, and we were sent back to find you.
Find me?
Yes. You're supposed to be able to help us from stopping something called Ravenloft.
She looks very confused.
And I'll just be like, exactly. The same look I had when we were told about this. But
get out a quill and a piece of paper and start writing this down. Maybe it'll make a good book one day.
And I'll just tell her exactly what this strange old magic guy told us.
And you're not a strange old magic guy?
I am not old. I'm still young. Ish.
Well, I suppose even though I don't look it, I guess I'm the strange old magic user here then, huh?
Truth. Remind me, did he mention something about this wand that she was carrying?
No.
No, okay. I couldn't remember.
No, all he said is that he believes that Amelia is the key to Ravenloft, but he was unclear if it was to stopping it or if she was the one that was going to cause it, but either way, you needed to find her.
Okay.
That's basically what he told you.
So nothing like looking for a needle in a haystack.
Well, you found her, didn't you?
Yeah.
It hasn't shown up yet.
Yeah. So I'll look to her and I'll be like, he didn't tell us his name either. He just teleported us here and told us what we needed to do, right?
I mean, you would actually probably recognize him, but yeah, that's basically what happened.
Okay.
You as Cashadin may like see the resemblance between that old dwarf that you met for just a few minutes, Marigor, I think was his name, when you were getting your identity back. He looked a lot like him. But, yeah. I mean, all dwarves look the same to you anyway, so.
Yeah, they're little chitlins. So, I just tell her, we're trying to get back to our time, we don't belong here, but where we belong is an absolute shit show. And we need to figure out exactly what it is that we need to do. Why we had to rescue you / find you.
At what Marigor was on about, Ulfgar says.
Yeah. That stuff.
Oh, this is, lying indeed. Amelia, you have, any idea what these fellows are talking about? And she starts shaking her head and she goes, not a damn thing.
I don't even know what's going on anymore.
And so I'm just going to be like, well, fuck! A little louder than I meant to, and just kind of look around.
Like, I mean, I have no idea what is Ravenloft? That sounds familiar, Ulfgar. I don't know what it is. And Ulfgar kind of sits for a second. He goes, but from the stories myself, Ravenloft is kind of the dark version of our world. Kind of like it's all dark and dreary and is run by vampires.
Yeah.
If I remember correctly.
That sounds about right.
So you're saying little Amelia here's the key to stopping it?
Or
sure, we'll go with that. it was very unclear what her role is to play. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it for you. She could be the one to cause it.
I'm here to cause it, then why haven't you killed me already?
Because that is... that information has not presented itself. If I were to kill you and you were the one to stop it, well, fuck my life.
It would pretty much void the whole reason that you were sent back. Oh.
She kind of just, like, looks down at the floor for a second and goes in her nose, and she looks back up and says, if it turns out that I am the key for it entering this world, would you kill me?
If you are the cause of Ravenloft, sweetheart, I wouldn't give it a second thought. There are a lot more lives than yours that I would have to worry about.
She kind of nods at you and says, good. I wanted to hear.
Tell you guys what, though. If you could do some research into this, see if maybe you can string up some connections, find us some more information about this. We actually have a little side gig that we need to actually help our little buddy out here with. And when we get back, I would put our heads together and figure this shit out.
Side gig? What do you mean?
Have you ever heard of insert name of weird dwarven city here?
Glitterheim?
Yeah, that thing.
Glitterheim?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have, actually.
Well, this, gnome, right? Yeah, gnome. This gnome here is looking to go there because his family was wiped out by some creature from this area, and this is the only name that he knows. So,
okay, so Mike, at hearing that, you don't know how he got that information.
Because Mike told me that information.
Did he?
Yeah, we were eating dinner.
He was the only one that I actually told.
Okay, I didn't know if you shared that information with them.
Only with him, not the other two.
Yeah. So we're going to go investigate, see what might be there. Who knows? Maybe fate will twist its way in there and we'll find a clue there that we can bring back to you guys.
She goes, well, if you don't mind it, I'd like to join you. Glitterholm was our destination with the group before we entered that mage tower, and if I can honor my comrades in any way, it would be to find what they were searching for.
Are you
emotionally stable to make that option?
I have nothing else to do.
Are you well enough to make the trip?
Yes, I believe I am.
I mean, if you feel you can help us out, I'll more than welcome the extra assistance.
Actually, I think spending a few weeks away from the city might be exactly what I need. After everything that's happened, I think just some time away to think might be the perfect thing for me.
And I'll look to Ulfgar and I'll be like, "Do you think this will be good?"
I think her being away from anything of Jex's influence might be good for her. She's always been adventurous. She's never wanted to stay in one place for too long.
I can hear that. And I'll wink at her.
She'll stand up and be like, we'll leave in the morning.
All right, I'll gather
everything I need by then.
All right, let me head back to my other comrades, and I will let them know that we'll be heading out to Glitterheim in the morning.
I will stay with Ulfgar tonight, and I will meet you at the Unicorn in the morning.
Sounds good.
Ulfgar, do you think we could round up some of the old crew and maybe get some information on Ravenloft? He'll kind of be like, well, I haven't spoken to some of them in some time. But I don't see any reason. If there's any other reason to get a hold of them, now would be it. Let's do it.
And I'll nod to him and I'll appreciate the assistance here. Bet you can't wait till we're going back to our own time.
Like, all right, get your asses back. I'll meet you there in the morning as well for a send-off.
All right, appreciate it. And snap my heels together, spin around, and head off.
Shiro and 13.
Ooh,
yeah.
What kind of mischief were you getting into while that was happening?
Well,
so they left. What happens next?
I'm just gonna sit there and have a meal. Like I told to be a good kitty, and I'm just gonna sit right here. And unless something comes through that door causing some problems, I'm pretty good.
And I'm just watching him.
Are you like tentatively like looking at me, just like seeing if I make any kind of weird moves? Just be like, oh my god, like, all right, come on, make a move, I'll be on you in a second.
Okay, so this will be fun. So,
oh god,
that's always the best.
So while you guys are kind of just sitting there, a figure will walk into the bar. I'll walk over to the barkeep and sit for a moment and, you know, order a drink and look around, and you know, you guys are some of the only patrons in. I mean, it's after lunch now. Most people have gone out, and it's really only you two and him and two of the regulars that you guys have seen now that you've been here for several days over on the other side of the bar. And this guy's not been in here. He's got his cowl pulled up. He's got like a dark green like cloak thing with a cowl. He's got like some nice looking leather boots on. Up at the bar, he kind of turns and looks around, and he nods over to the bartender. A bartender comes over, he talks to him, hands him some coins, and he grabs two. He picks up three mugs, and he kind of walks over to your table, and he sets a mug down in front of each of you, and he sits himself down and puts a leg up on the table and says, "Hi, on me for the day."
I just look at 13.
I'm just going to sit there. I'm going to take the drink. I'm going to have myself a night, hold it up, and I'm going to look to him and say, well, cheers, my good sir. Thank you for the beverage.
And oh, wait, he's still disguised as a woman, right?
Oh, yeah. No, he's not the woman.
No, I changed back. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to raise my glass. I'm going to insight check to see if he has any ill intentions for us.
Okay.
A guy just offering me a free drink and not disguised as a woman, I'm going to be very questionable about that.
Whoa, excuse me. That's
Let's see.
My apologies.
16.
I mean, he seems a little bit creepy. But, you know, it seems like his offer of a drink was all good.
There's no ill intent.
No ill intent from offering you the drink.
Okay.
So as he sits there and you look at him, he drinks of his while you're doing that. You guys get a good look of him. He's in like a kind of very fine and like a little bit shiny, like studded leather. And he's got a sword at his side, and you can see a couple other maybe like daggers, kind of like one maybe in like a shoulder sheath and one at his other hip, and he's human, he appears to be, and he says, "Hey, I haven't seen either you around, foreigner and sir nobleman. What do you fancy around town here?" I'm pretty good about knowing the locals, and I don't know you very well. I don't know either of you.
I wish to say, well, we are just simple travelers. We came here looking to take care of some personal matters, And we're right here just having ourselves a nice beverage. But what brings you? You seem to be a local man, huh? So you know a lot of people around here?
I do.
So there's a certain gentleman I heard rumors about. His name was, I think, a Jex. He was assaulted last night. Have you heard anything about that?
I heard about it. Haven't looked into it myself.
Oh, okay. I heard that he had a wife and that the gentleman had some issues going on. Is everything all right with that? Do you know?
Well, I think his house was invaded and he was thrown out a window, which is hilarious.
Right? Come on. That seems amazingly funny. I mean, yeah, he's fine though, right? That's all that matters.
Yeah, as far as I know, he's fine. Listen, I'm not here to talk about that. How much you guys know of the local, how do I want to put it? Local pleasantries?
Oh, the pleasantries.
Of course. We
haven't really partaked in that. We just, you know, keep it to ourselves until we get our business done and we're out the door.
Fair enough. Well, and he kind of lowers his voice a little bit and he leans up to the table and he's like, well, I'm kind of a proprietor of some of the nicer pleasantries. Again, you don't seem to be from around here. Is there any interest from you?
I want to lean in. Well, my dear sir, you know, I am a man that looks for very exotic things. And there's certainly a certain type I'm looking for, but I'm not sure if you could be able to obtain it.
He's like, oh, trust me, I can obtain it.
Really?
So, oh, absolutely.
I am thinking of a certain type, you know. One with nice big claws, you know, some nice cat-like eyes, and perhaps a bit of, you know, feline personality, if you're catching my drift.
He kind of looks at you for a second and says, that's not the kind of pleasantry I was talking about, but I can look into it.
Oh. Oh, I just lean back in shock and just be like a little blushing and stuff like that. Oh, how embarrassing. I so insulted myself there. I do apologize, my dear sir. I thought you were that kind of person. I mean, apologize.
I am. I just don't have any on my person, clearly.
Oh, of course not clearly. But if that was the case, I'm looking for a bit of information if you could be able to retrieve that for me.
How about this? You buy some of my stuff, I'll look into it for you.
Well, what do you have to sell? I lean in, whispering. Well,
on my person, I've got a little bit of pipeweed, the elven stuff.
Ooh.
I've got some drake root. I even have some glitter stim.
Do I know any of that substance about what their what they look like, what they can or anything like that?
I don't know, would you?
I mean, I've been in the business of being a rogue, of stealing some things, trading some things.
Of most of this stuff. Give me a history roll though.
Okay.
Give me three history rolls. One for each.
Yeah.
Okay, so pipeweed's pretty common. It's basically
just it's Mary J.
Yeah, it's a plant that you would dry out and smoke causes some minor hallucinogenic effects.
Okay.
It's typically not addictive, but it can be. Okay. Drake root's a little bit stronger. Would you roll 13? That's probably fine. Drake root is it's pretty rare, and it's usually like a poisonous plant. But it works as a powerful sedative and a powerful addictive, whatever it is. Basically, it puts you it's immediate, helps you sleep, and like immediate boom sleep. You have crazy weird dreams, so you're kind of like hallucinating without any danger. In theory, that's why people like it. And it is also can be addictive, but not as much as some of the other stuff. And Glitter Stim, you don't know much about. It's a fairly new thing.
New stuff on the market, right?
Kind of newer stuff on the market. You don't know much about it other than you've heard the name of it before.
All right, I'm going to be like at first of the other two. I'm just going to be like, oh, okay. And then I'd be interested about the Drake root. And then when I heard about Glitter Dust, I'm just going to be like questionable about it. I'm like, Glitter Dust? May if I take a look at that myself, my dear sir?
Oh, yeah, it's new stuff. Have you not seen any of it?
No, I've heard whispers about it. But, you know, I've never really actually seen the stuff. You know what I mean?
Right. Hang on a second. He kind of digs in his bag for a moment. And he brings out this like vial. It's like a small vial that has like this golden powder looking stuff in it. It's like if cocaine was gold, it's kind of what it looks like. If you know what cocaine is, Black.
Yes.
It's like a gold powder kind of looking thing.
Well, I'm going to look to him and be like, how much are you selling for each of this stuff?
He's like, well, I'll be honest. This is all I got. But it's a lot of stuff. You don't need much more than, I don't know, maybe a gram of this stuff. Not even. Just even a pinch of it will feel you a little bit. I sell this for 5 gold a pop. Not this whole container, but each hit I sell for about 5 gold a hit. It's very hard to get hold of.
All right. Well, Z, okay, let me ask you, Z. Yes. I want to do a check to know, or if I would need to know if I could be able to put this stuff into a liquefied state concoction and be able to get the same potency. Do you want me to roll for that?
You wouldn't know enough about it.
Okay. So
this stuff is too new, and unless you tried it, you wouldn't know offhand.
Well, I want to talk about for that the Drake root and pretty much weed.
The weed, yeah. So the pipe weed is almost exclusively set fire to and smoked. The Drake root, once it's been cleansed of its poison, can be ingested in just about any way. You can chop it up and put it in a food. You can mix it in a liquid and down it, that kind of thing. Once it's in its dried root state, or you could just eat it straight up, it works pretty much however way you ingest it. Okay. This Glitter Stim stuff, this guy says, works in one of two ways. You can either basically put it, you know, take the pinch and put it in your mouth, or you can like snort it, he'll tell you, and it works. And that's the way to immediately happen. Or he has found out that it works if you mix it with non-alcoholic beverages. The alcohol kind of does something to it that doesn't make it work well, but just like water or you know, like coffee or tea, mixing it in with that seems to have the same effect. It doesn't hit you as quick, but it still works.
Okay.
So he would say he would be hesitant to change its form, but it kind of like dissolves like sugar in a drink and seems to work just as well.
Okay. Well, then I want to ask the gentleman, how much is it for a vial of each altogether?
Again, he'll sell you a hit of Glitter Stim for 5 gold a piece. He's willing to sell the Drake root. He'll sell you an entire root for 3 gold, and each pouch of the elven pipeweed he has is going to be a gold apiece.
Okay, and how much of each of this stuff does he have?
How much do you want?
I want 5 of the Drake Roots, and I'm going to want maybe 3 vials of the Glitter Dust and maybe 10 things of the weed.
He goes, all right. Well, I need to go use the restroom real quick, and he'll wink at you. He kind of stands up and stretches and downs his drink and walks over, sits his drink on the bar, and heads to the latrine.
All right. Well, as he goes into the latrine, as he's getting up, I'm going to say, well, as you can understand, my dear sir, I'm not going to want to go myself. I'll be sending an associate there in a quiet moment, if that's all right with you.
He'll kind of look over and he'll wink at you and says, why are you following me to the bathroom? And then he'll go back.
I just nod and I'm just like, okay. And then I'm going to go to a side into like a corridor. It's empty. There's nobody around. At the angle I'm standing at, only Shiro is going to be able to see it. And I'm going to change my
form. Duck down next to the bar.
I'm going to change it to the form of the guy that's being wanted. And then I'm going to walk up into the bar or into the latrine. And I'm going to be like with the money at hand. And I'm just going, of course, in like my, I'm holding it one hand as I'm just going to come up to it. And I'm going to like knock on it.
Right. So Shiro, as he changes form and kind of heads into the bathroom, you'll see the other like two like regulars on the other side kind of like look up and notice him, and one of their eyes will get really big and I'll kind of like whisper to the other friend and they'll go, holy shit. And you hear that a little too loud. And then they'll start like whispering to each other and drinking their drinks.
Okay. Fuck's sake.
I thought there was no one else there.
It was you guys and then a couple of the regulars.
Well, I want to be at an angle. Well, I want to go at an angle no one else would see, but maybe.
Right, they didn't see you change, but they did see the guy that has been described to everybody.
Oh, okay, then I'm okay with that.
Okay, so what do you want now?
I want.
How much of each thing do you want?
Okay, so I wanted 3 of the Glitter Dust. 4 of the Drake Root. Oh no, 5 of the Drake Root and 10 of the weed.
Whoa.
Okay, so.
And then I want to talk to him about, like, since I'm buying in bulk, if I could be able to get a discounted price.
50 gold pieces.
50? Can I use persuasion to dumb it down to 45?
Sure.
Because I'm buying in bulk.
He goes, you know what? Tell you what. Since you're being nice, I'll give you one of the glitter stems for free. Since you're buying so much. 45 it is.
Sure, I'll take that. So let me put that in my inventory. So minus it out 50?
Minus 45.
Oh, minus 45. Okay.
45 okay. Gold.
Great.
You'll now have 10 elven tape weed. 5 was it Drake Root? Is that what they called it?
Yeah.
Drake Root. Oop.
I am so afraid of what he's gonna do with that.
And what 3 glitter stem?
Was it 3 glitter stem?
Okay. Yeah, that's what you asked for. It's 3 glitter stem.
I thought he's adding it.
Oh,
an extra.
No, he's just not charging you for one.
Oh, okay. And then it was 10 of the weed, right? Yeah.
Right. So that's 10 elven pipe weed, 5 Drake Root, and 3 glitter stem.
Okay.
All right. And he'll kind of shake your hand and be like, pleasure doing business. I might stop by here more often.
Oh, I'll be here.
Let your boss know that I'm always... Always here to help. And he'll kind of like slip a card in your pocket and he'll leave.
Well, as he's saying that, my boss, I just go, I have no boss. I am the boss.
Whatever you say. And he'll leave. He kind of leaves. And Shira, you see the guy, the guy kind of walk out of the door or leave the latrine, and he'll come over, and as he's walking by your table, he'll make eye contact and nod at you, and then he'll leave the bar.
Just nod. Did those two guys saw Cliff change, right?
They didn't see him change forms, no, but they saw the guy leave.
Okay. Okay, it's fine. I thought they saw him change forms.
Yeah, not quite. All right, and at that point, the other two, the gnome and Cash, will kind of walk into the bar, and we will go ahead and call it for this week, I think.